Good morning. I'm Matthew Johnson, a senior minister here at the Unitarian Universalist Church in Rockford, Illinois. And welcome. Whether you are joining us live at 10 Central on April 12th or later, welcome. Whether you are a member or a friend of the Unitarian Universalist Church in Rockford, or a member or friend of another Unitarian Universalist congregation who's found your way here because you need worship today, or if you are exploring religion anew and have found us, welcome. Whether you are frightened or grieving or determined or curious or sad or furious, welcome. Whoever you are and whatever brings you here, welcome. We're coming to you from the sanctuary here at the church. With me today is Tim Anderson, my colleague in worship and the music director at the church, and Autumn Powell, our office manager, is in the back of the hall running technology for us today. Our worship associate, Nikki Tickner, has pre-recorded their testimony, which you'll hear later in the service. We had a little technical glitch this morning as we were getting started, but we figured it out, so we started a few minutes later, but you are with us. And we are happy to have you with us for Easter worship this morning. Chris Ainsworth, our membership coordinator, is at home and chiming in on the Facebook feed. And I saw you all joining as Tim was playing the prelude, and it's great to see your names pop up joining together in worship. If you are watching this on Facebook, you see a comment area. We invite you to comment this morning. Be present with us. Let us know that you are here. Do be thoughtful about your choices about what to post. It is very public and anyone can see. If you would prefer not to be distracted by comments, you can hover over the video and click on the little icon of a speech balloon with a line through it, and that'll enter you into quiet mode. Or if you're on a tablet or a phone, you can swipe right. And those comments will go away. We're going to mostly follow our regular format today. Indeed, we're going to follow our regular Easter format today, though, of course, some things will be different. I do hope that some of you took the time to gather some kind of bread and some kind of beverage for our communion service, which we do once a year, and we will do today. The ritual of how we worship most weeks is a source of comfort and connection for us, a ritual. And as somebody said to me the other day, it's the only way I know what day of the week it is. It is a source of comfort for me, too. And I'm glad that we are worshiping together. So let us worship together. I've been meaning the last few weeks to get the bell and to ring the bell to begin us, and I keep forgetting it a few feet over there, so I'm going to go get it. It's not far. And I'll ring the bell and we'll begin with worship. We'll sing together 269, Lo, the Day of Days, and the words will be up on your screen.
Thank you.
We're going to keep singing this morning. Autumn, will you hit the unmute on the upper choir mic on the board? I think I may have muted it for the ordination. Okay, now you will hear Tim better than you just did. We're going to keep singing Name Unnamed is our hymn for the month, and we're going to sing verses 1 and 3 this morning. We'll put the words up on the screen and sing together. I'm so glad that you are here for worship with us. If today is your first time with us, we're especially happy to have you joining us online. Please do take a moment to like our Facebook page as a way to stay in touch with our activities and programs and other online events during this time. You can also go to uurockford.org and click on newsletter sign up to share your information with us. And we look forward to when we can gather again in person and hope to meet you then. The flaming chalice is the symbol of our faith, a beacon of truth, a fire for justice, and a warmth for the soul. I'll light our chalice here at the church as we speak and sing together our response. Love is the spirit of this church, and reason is its guide. To dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in freedom, and to serve human need. This is our covenant. Now we'll sing together our chalice response song.
May love shine forth through us today. May light of reason guide our way. May beauty, truth, and joy become a flame that burns in every.
Well, it is Easter, and we are celebrating this tradition and talking about what it means. So I put on my robe, even though it's just Tim and Autumn and I here in the service, which I do for Easter. And Sandy Campbell yesterday, while nobody was here, brought flowers and lilies for our sanctuary to make it beautiful and seasonal. And we do, as we do each year, draw our service from this Hymns of the Spirit hymn book, the Unitarian hymn book published in the 1930s, and there's a nameplate in the beginning of each hymnal, and this book was presented to the church by Miss Nita Zayok. That is the same Zayok family as the Zayok building, soon to be the Embassy Suites Hotel downtown in Rockford, and she was part of this congregation. So this is from the shorter form of the communion. There are parts for you to say along, and when we get to those parts, Autumn will put those pages up on the screen for you this morning. And if you have some bread and some beverage of some kind, wine or juice or whatever you might have, your coffee will work. We have a liberal interpretation of this ritual this morning. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Dearly beloved, we have received it that Jesus, on the night before he died, as he supped with his disciples in an upper chamber, took bread and broke it, likening it to his body, and poured out wine as a visible parable of his blood. As we repeat this act in remembrance of him, may the Spirit, which kept him steadfast even unto death, be quickened in us. We remember also that the bread and wine have been to Christians in all ages a sign of their fellowship with him and with one another, a source of strength, a witness to the power of love. Conscious of the weakness of our own hearts and the needs of our fellows, let us here renew our communion with him and with all faithful servants of God who have found strength and joy in doing the work of God upon earth. Let us pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, and may we perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name. I invite you to join me in the confession. We'll put that up on the screen for you. We come not into thy presence, most holy Lord God, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and abiding mercies. Remembering this day the great heart and passion of a Son of Man of long ago, we are ashamed of our selfish and imperfect lives. We would here be turned to the way of his brave and tender spirit, and find that wholeness of life which shall be at once a divine blessing for us and a divine ministry from us. Forgive us our failures and shortcomings, and by thy grace strengthen our weak desires for goodness, that we may henceforth serve thee without fear and without shame all the days of our lives. Amen. We'll share now together the Beatitudes, the blessings that Jesus spoke to his followers. I'll read the part in regular type on your screen and you the part in bold on your screen. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And the second is like unto it, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Let the bread here be set apart from the bounty of the earth. Let the bread here, set apart from the bounty of the earth, be to us a token of all the good we receive and cannot ourselves effect. And let us with quiet hearts wait for that highest good of all, the presence and the Spirit of God. I made bread yesterday. I used my last packet of yeast. So, bread. Let the wine here outpoured be to us a token of the self-forgetting good which all must needs do for others if we are to share the fullness of the divine blessing. And let us offer ourselves not to be ministered unto, but to minister. Let us pray. Infinite and all-holy One, we would present ourselves, our souls, and bodies to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto Thee. And we pray that as the grain once scattered upon the mountains is here gathered into one bread, so Thy separated children of every nation, kindred, and tongue may by Thy grace be united in one living spirit of righteousness and peace. And as this wine came forth from the fruit of the vine, so may Thy people, continually abiding as branches of the true vine, bring forth the good fruit of good living to Thy glory. The Lord Jesus, on the same night in which He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is My body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." And in the same manner, He also took the cup when He had supped, saying, "This is the cup, the New Testament of My blood. Do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of Me." So I invite you at home, if you are following along, to take a piece of bread, to dip it in your beverage, your wine or juice, and to take and eat in remembrance of the message of love. Let us join in the silent prayer that the truth, that the Spirit which was within Jesus may be in us also, enabling us to know the truth, to do the will of God, and to abide in peace. I invite you to say together these words of prayer, which are known to many of you. They rhyme in Aramaic, and though we think they are authentic, the prayer that Jesus spoke and taught to those who followed Him. We'll put it up on the screen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Now may the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, that peace which the world can neither give nor take away, abide in our hearts to bless us this day and forevermore. This concludes our service of communion, which we do each year in memory of these teachings of love and to unite us around the world as people are this morning, seeking ways to do this ritual in new ways across time and space, and we have joined with them in doing so. Here's where we're at as a congregation. We're on this stay-at-home order at least through the end of April. We suspect that although there may be some small loosening in some places, large gatherings will not be recommended, and we will not do them for quite some time. So we'll be having worship online only for a while. We're going to have a Seder online on Tuesday at 5:30, and the link is in Kairos. On Friday's update, I think my column and another place had two different addresses, so look in your email on Monday, and we will send the correct Zoom meeting ID and password for you to members and friends of the church. If you don't get it, let us know, and we'll make sure you have the right meeting ID. We've had a little trouble with different meeting IDs getting out there, so we're going to try to get that tightened up for you so you know where to go. But whatever you have, there's information in the Kairos about some recipes and things you can prepare and substitutes for the items that you might use in order to join us online for a Seder on Tuesday at 5:30. Your whole family and children, all welcome to join around the screen to see one another and do that ritual together. Do check in with each other. If you're thinking of someone you usually see at coffee hour or some other time at the church, call them up, send a note, reach out. I know some of our small groups and others are meeting and connecting with each other, but keep connecting across time and space. Please reach out to me if you need anything. If you're a member of the church and you got laid off or lost tip or gig income or need support in any way, let me know. The staff is mostly working from home, but we have email and phone and video conference, and we are here for you. Every week we take up an offering to support the work of justice and mercy in the world. 80% of what we collect each day goes to serve the cause of justice and mercy. This morning we are collecting for the Interfaith Committee for Detained Immigrants. This group works in the Chicagoland area and at the McHenry County Jail to provide pastoral and spiritual support to detained immigrants detained by ICE and to their families. Despite this pandemic and the orders, ICE continues to detain people and take them away from their families and make them unsafe, both in body, mind, and spirit. We condemn that and we stand on the side and work with those who are providing pastoral, legal, and emotional support to those families just in our own backyard. So you can give by texting the number on the screen or by going to uurockford.org/donate and be sure to select Share the Plate as we give this offering to the Interfaith Committee for Detained Immigrants. Our offering will now be given and received.
So for me, the holy is a feeling of sacredness, spirituality, a sense of calm and content, a feeling of rightness within the world. This sense of all is right in the world can come at unexpected times. I often feel it while running trails out in the woods, while the sun is shining and the air smells fresh, or following a joyous time with friends, or a powerful conversation with someone. I most often and most strongly feel it when I am watching my boys sleep. So much peace and love. They are so content and safe and sound and quiet. I can feel my love for them deep down into my bones, and so strongly I feel like I am going to burst. This feels like holiness to me. I, like many of you, have been spending a lot, if not all, of my time at home this past month. There's a lot of family time and even more kid time. And during these times where the walls start to feel like they are closing in, and space and quiet is a precious commodity, it can be hard to find or feel the holiness in relationships. Simply put, we are getting on each other's nerves quickly, and often it feels the opposite of divine. On the other hand, I have found there is a lot of holiness in isolation. Sure, there are sad parts of feeling isolated, as they say, being all dressed up with nowhere to go, although I'm not really changing out of my pajamas too much these days, but I miss my activities and my job and my events, things we looked forward to. But during these times of isolation, the effort I am making to keep connected with family and friends is genuine and intentional. We have all become experts at Zoom, FaceTime, house party, and any other type of technology that allows us to feel connected. We are playing video games online with one another, scheduling coffee and wine dates via video, arranging Zoom dates, play dates for our kids, and making an effort to check in on one another. These are the same friends who, before all of this, with the busyness of work and kids' activities and life, I sometimes may go a week or more without talking to at all, let alone finding the time to see them in person or in video. This rich and creative connection that we have built feels divine to me in these less than divine times. I hope you all are well.
Song.
Thank you, Tim. Wonderful. And I realized, well, actually, Autumn and Tim realized that I skipped the invocation earlier. I moved right into the communion service. And that's okay. That was a way of beginning our worship. But what that means I forgot to do was to name out loud with you all those we are holding in prayer, their families as we hold in prayer and wait to perform for them a service of memory and love for those who have died since we began this shutdown or whose service was scheduled during that time. That includes the family of Scotty Lichtenheld, Maggie Thieneman, Frank Dyka, Verna Hayes. And I ask you to hold all of their families and friends in your thoughts and your prayers in this strange time as they wait to gather to say goodbye. There are two readings this morning. The first is an excerpt from the book Sisters in the Wilderness by Dolores Williams. Dolores Williams is one of the founders of the womanist theology movement, a movement of black women to describe the meaning of theology and God and love and suffering and hope in terms that made sense for the lives of black women. So this is an excerpt from that book, Sisters in the Wilderness. Jesus' own words in Luke 4 and his ministry of healing the human body, mind, and spirit suggest that Jesus did not come to redeem humans by showing them God's love manifest in the death of God's innocent child on a cross erected by a cruel, imperialistic, patriarchal power. Rather, the text suggests that the Spirit of God in Jesus came to show human life, to show redemption through a perfect ministerial vision of righting relations between body, mind, and spirit. A female and male inclusive vision, Jesus' ministry of righting relationships involved raising the dead, those separated from life and community, casting out demons, for example, ridding the mind of destructive forces, prohibiting the flourishing of positive, peaceful life, and proclaiming the word of life that demanded the transformation of tradition so that life could be lived more abundantly. Thus, Jesus was quick to remind his critics that humans were not made for the Sabbath, rather the Sabbath was made for humans. God's gift to humans through Jesus was to invite them to participate in this ministerial vision, whosoever will, let them come, of righting relations. The response to this invitation by human principalities and powers was the horrible deed. The cross represents the evil of humankind trying to kill the ministerial vision of life in relation that Jesus brought to humanity. The resurrection does not depend upon the cross for life, for the cross only represents historical evil trying to defeat good. The resurrection of Jesus and the flourishing of God's Spirit in the world as the result represents the life of the ministerial vision, gaining victory over the evil attempt to kill it. Thus, to respond meaningfully to black women's historic experience of surrogacy oppression, the womanist theologian must show that redemption of humans can have nothing to do with any kind of surrogate or substitute role Jesus was reputed to have played in a bloody act that supposedly gained victory over sin and evil. Black women are intelligent people living in a technological world where nuclear bombs, defilement of the earth, racism, sexism, economic injustices attest to the presence and power of evil in the world. Perhaps not many people today can believe that evil and sin were overcome by Jesus' death on the cross, that is, that Jesus took human sin upon himself and therefore saved humankind. Rather, it seems more intelligent and more scriptural to understand that redemption had to do with God giving humankind new vision to see the resources for positive, abundant, relational life. Redemption has to do with God through the ministerial vision, giving humankind the ethical thought and practice upon which to build positive, productive quality of life. Hence, the kingdom of God theme and the ministerial vision of Jesus does not point to death. It is not something one has to die to reach. Rather, the kingdom of God is a metaphor of hope God gives those attempting to right the relations between self and self, between self and others, between self and God, as prescribed in the Sermon on the Mount, and the Golden Rule and the commandment to show love above all else. And the second reading, a poem by Jan Richardson. The poem is called While It Was Still Dark, and draws on the text of John 20, verse 1, early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb. While it was still dark, while it was still night, while she could not see, when she thought death held sway, while she grieved, while she wept, while it was still dark, resurrection began. I invite you to breathe in and out wherever you are, whenever you are. Let the spirit of love, named and unnamed, mysterious power of life and hope and spring, power of compassion and mercy and love, flow through you and among you. Listen with your heart for the hearts of others across time and space, the sounds of birds and a little traffic and dogs barking and children playing. You might hear across town and across the world. Listen with your heart for the ache and the hope, the sorrow of those who grieve their dead, the frantic work of doctors and nurses and scientists. Listen with your heart for the sound of caring and love and neighborliness over the fence and across the street. Listen with your heart for the sound of love. Amen. The anthem that Tim is about to play this morning, the words come from a poem by Ralph Waldo Emerson, that transcendentalist and Unitarian leader, entitled Music, which was written by him in the 1840s.
Skyborne music still, it sounds from all things old, it sounds from all things young, from all that's fair, from all that's foul, peals out a cheerful song. Not only in the rose, it is not only in the bird, not only where the rainbow glows, nor in the song of woman heard, but in the darkest, meanest things. Always something sings, always something sings, always, always something sings. 'Tis not stars alone, nor in the cup of budding flowers, nor in the red breast melody. are in the bow that smiles and showers, but in the mud and scum of things they're always, always something sings. They're always something sings. They're always something sings.
Lean on me when you're not strong. Bill Withers, who wrote and sang that song, died last week at age 81, not of COVID, but of heart disease. His family said that he was a very private man, but he loved his close friends and he loved the world. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll help you carry on. He also wrote the song, Lovely Day. When I wake up in the morning, love, something without warning bears heavy on my mind. And then I look at you and the world's all right with me and I know it's going to be a lovely day. He holds that note at the end of Lovely Day for 18 seconds. Don't try that at home. You will pass out. When something bears heavily on my mind, lean on me and I know it's going to be a lovely day. It's hard not to see one another in person. And I see what happens to people's faces on Zoom when they see a friend or even an acquaintance. When we have that, we are in this together feeling that Nikki described in her testimony when we lean on each other. We are seeing now some of the extremities of human compassion. We see some who are there for each other, who are abiding by the need to be physically distant, who are getting groceries from elderly neighbors, who are drawing hearts on their sidewalks, employers keeping their people on payroll, scrambling to get funds, perhaps, to do so. And we see, of course, healthcare workers and teachers and grocery store employees who are trying their best to make this work as best it can. And we also see those who are not. Employers who are not taking care of their people, people not keeping distance from each other and putting us all at greater risk. Profiteers and scammers and Zoom bombers and those who would deliberately put the lives of voters at risk to try to win a state Supreme Court seat, shame on them. We see the best and the worst. Sometimes we wake and without warning or with plenty of warning, something bears heavy on our mind. And sometimes we see one another's face, we hear one another's voice, we connect in some way and we feel less alone. Someone to lean on and we think, even in the muck and the mud, even in the grief and the sorrow, even in the waiting outside the tomb, we can do this. And there is love in this day, not sentimental cheapness, but lovely deep down, for we are there for each other. The women, Mary, his mother, Mary the Magdalene, his best friend, perhaps, or more, Salome, mother of James and John, two of his disciples, they went together, together. The gospel accounts give different versions of which women went, although they all agree on the first two and how many, but they all agree they went together. And in so doing, they enacted what Dolores Williams names as his ministerial vision, a preaching of the abundant relational life. There are days like that when we are together, when we feel abundant relational life. And there are days not like that. There are days when despair grows and the loneliness is deadly and when the people around us are not people we can lean on, and there are days that are too hard, when the vision of abundant relational life seems like a cruel joke, when we're separated from our family and friends, when our relationships with others are not based on mutuality or kindness, instead they feel merely transactional or worse, exploitive and abusive. And Easter comes and says, always something sings. Really? Really? Alleluia? Really? In the morgue? In isolation? In our moments of despair? Something sings? Easter answers, yes. Yes. Forget the bunnies, even the tulips and the daffodils, forget even the chocolate. We're getting deep down now. In the mud and scum, says Emerson, even there something sings. And he wrote these lines of resilience and courage, which you heard Tim sing a moment ago. He wrote these lines, Emerson did, having already buried in his life two of his brothers when they were in their 20s, his father when he was only 8, and his first wife and his child. So these are not cheap verses, not sentimentality. Something sings. This is not cheap. Dolores Williams reminds us that the salvation message of Easter is not death, it is life. She rejects the atonement theology that praises death and affirms that it is life, community, love that is worthy of praise. Death tries to destroy life. Empire tries to destroy freedom. The cult of power seeks to obliterate difference. But the women came together to the tomb. And in the dark, in their tears, resurrection began, which is to say, community persisted. They came together to grieve together, and in so doing, witnessed and continued the ministerial vision, abundant life. If the community fell apart, if they all just went their own way, if no one told the story and no one repeated the teaching, there would be no resurrection. In my theology, resurrection isn't Jesus coming back to life. It is the community still practicing his radical message of incarnational love. Every moment is a knife's edge, a teetering between the cult of death and the vision of abundant life, between a lovely day and a day of despair. And it is the choices we make, including in our grief and sense of loss, that hold us fast to the vision of abundant relational life. This vision does not deny the reality of grief, sorrow, and death. Indeed, the vision of abundant relational life treats those losses with gravity and sacred tears. For each person matters. Their life matters, and their death is not a statistic, but a personal earthquake. Treating each person as sacred, seeing each moment as holy, moving through the world with compassion, love, and mercy for others, this is the vision that we are called to. And on Easter, when we celebrate the possibility of renewal and the teachings of Joshua Bar Joseph, also known as Jesus of Nazareth, we are invited into this vision. Invited to treat the stranger as our neighbor and to love our neighbors as though they and we were incarnations of the divine, because we are. Because we all are. I titled this sermon Thea and Joshua because I want to lift up the intimate nature of the love between the holy and the human. The incarnational, familiar, close as the beating of your heart, truth expressed in the way that Jesus, a Greek version of Joshua, son of Joseph, which would be Joshua bar Joseph, that's his name, the way that Joshua refers to Abba, which is like Papa or Dada, a term of endearment and love, closeness. The teachings over and over again in word and deed, as Dolores Williams reminds us, point to the close relational care, washing the feet, eating together, healing the sick, feeding the people, the intimacy of love between those who care for each other, and the call to expand the circle wider and wider still. The paradigmatic story of his teaching, how the Samaritan, the one others despise, is the one who shows relational kindness and concern while others pass by on the road. Over and over again, Joshua offers to the people what they seem to need: encouragement for some, riddles for others, food for some, healing for others, chastisement and the overturning of tables, sometimes too. Woe to you, sometimes. Love is contextual and relational. And so if you are the kind of person who wonders right now, what would Jesus do? They would stay home and call and text strangers and friends with jokes and kind words and encouragement. They would mourn the deaths and cry out at injustice and profiteering and the racism which is making this crisis, like so many others, so unequal. They would also remind us that we need one another to lean on. When we grieve, when we feel alone, when we wonder if we would ever get through this and how, we need one another. And that need of one another and the responsiveness to that need is one way in which the Holy is manifest. Straight-talking lover, speaking the truth that refreshes and frees. What is God? What is divinity? That's our question for April. And those who experienced the community that Joshua led, who learned from those he taught, had an answer to that question: love. If you have not love, you have not God. And what is that love? What is that? Well, it's real. It's gritty. It's about care and abundant relationship. It is going to the tomb together to mourn. It's calling to say, how are you? It's keeping your distance to stay alive. It's talking it through when things are hard. It's laughter and quiet, feeding each other and washing your own hands. The feet washing will need to wait for another time. It is lived out in concrete, everyday acts of intimate love. The process theologians say that God is a verb, not a noun, and that we experience Theo, the intimate spirit of love, in incarnational moments when our human need is displayed, when we see each other face to face or across pixels and wires and recognize our common humanity, the ache of our hearts, the joy of our smile, the longing of our souls. Something always sings. Really? Yes. Yes. In the mud and the scum and the darkness before the tomb, even if the tomb is not empty, even when the grief lays us low, the presence of love can be made manifest. Can be. When our hearts reach for another, when we go together, when we care for each other, that's when love is stronger than death. Sometimes Christians talk about what it means to be Easter people in a Good Friday world. Well, we are in a Good Friday world. And I don't want to skip ahead. Loss and grief and sorrow are real. Fear is real. And you may feel alone, but we are not really alone. We are apart together, for each other. The science is clear that what we are doing is working, so we need to keep at it. But keeping each other safe, it's working. So don't stop. We're loving each other into more life. What does it mean to be Easter people in a Good Friday world when we understand the vision of relational abundance to be the message and the good news? It means to love each other fiercely, concretely, in this real world. It means friendship that is deep. It means lovers who respect each other. It means families that are honest and compassionate at once. It means neighbors who look out for each other. It means mourning together. And it means smiling together at the sweetness of memory. These everyday things let our light shine. They show the divinity that is in each of us and is enacted in relationship. They let that light shine into the world. Lo, the day of days is here. And the new life of spring reminds us that after the winter, life returns. We're still in winter. Emotionally, economically, spiritually, we're still there. So this Easter isn't a victory march, but a reminder that the cracks are how the light gets in. Not a parade, but a song that sings still in our heart. Not the end of the story, but a reminder of the vision we seek and try to live. And isn't that true every year, really? We're not there yet. Love isn't cheap and it isn't finished. It gets down in the mud, wails together, and it gets up together, out of the dirt, and it picks up the pieces and goes with us into the new day, lives between us and among us, and sings, always something sings, not a victory, a reminder of how and why we might love one another this day and every day. Amen. We'll sing together, A Promise Through the Ages Rings. A song by Unitarian composer Alicia Carpenter is based on that St. Emerson text, Always Something Sings. We'll put the words up on the screen and you sing together. I have extinguished our chalice here at the sanctuary, but not the light of truth, the fire of commitment, or the warmth of community, that beloved community that sustains us when things are hard and helps us celebrate when things are good, that we carry with us until we are together again. I'll read our benediction and we'll sing our closing blessing. I look forward to seeing some of you on Tuesday for our Seder service that'll take place in place of the regular weekly happy hour, which will continue the following week. Be well, be safe, take care of one another. The words of our benediction from the prophet Isaiah in the Hebrew Scriptures, chapter 55. For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands.
Go in peace, go in peace, go in peace.